Hi, this is Annie Dance. For those who don't know me, I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in the Lake Lore area of Rutherford County, North Carolina, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Please subscribe and follow my work at anniedance.substack.com. You can simply type your email address in and click subscribe. And paid subscribers have access to additional details such as scoops where and exclusives where I highlight what is going on with crime, courts, police, and policy issues. So, of course, today, October 7th, 2024, marks the beginning of the first full week of power slowly being restored to parts of Western North Carolina, and specifically where I am in Green Hill in Rutherford County, North Carolina, just outside of Lake Lore. We were fortunate enough at our home to get power restored, and now I'm able to more fully report on what is going on. So, as you may have seen my previous coverage from last week, there were several stories I literally wrote by candlelight on my phone, on Substack, and on Facebook. Please follow my work there too. And I'm also the editor of a fairly new group called Lake Lore News. I encourage you and invite you to join that Facebook group to follow what's happening in the community too. So, shortly, the North Carolina State Board of Elections executive director is hosting a press availability to discuss the effects of Helene and what it may look like for the 2024 election. So let's see what she has to say. And as always, please contact me with any tips or questions. My email and information is on anniedance.substack.com. Again, click. You put your email in, or you can click no thanks, and you can see my work from Hurricane Helene most recently. And now that I have power fully back, of course, I will be working on many more stories to come.
Loud and clear. Karen, I see you. Do you want to check your mic real quick?
Yes, thank you. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. We're going to wait a couple minutes. We have more than 100 people who have accepted invitation to this. We have 70 showing up right now, and I've just gotten a few more, so we'll give them a few minutes to come in. Try to get started about, I don't know, 2:08 or so.
Great. Thanks, Pat.
Of this Hurricane Helene webpage as soon as possible after this press availability ends. So you will be able to access it from our website probably within 15 or so minutes after this ends. So Karen, I think if you're ready, go ahead.
Great. And you've pressed record?
Yes, I did this time. I see the red blinking light. So we're good to go there.
Great. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today and for helping to get accurate information to the voters in Western North Carolina as the response to Helene continues. I'm Karen Brinson Bell. I'm the Executive Director of the State Board of Elections. I'm here with Paul Cox, our General Counsel to the board. I'm going to give some brief remarks followed by Q&A, where we will answer questions that you may have. If you do want to ask a question, please put your name and media organization into the chat, and then we'll call on you after my remarks. Our continued thanks go out to all of the emergency responders, county election officials, and everyday individuals who are stepping up to assist Western North Carolinians. We especially appreciate reporters from Western North Carolina who are participating today under very tough conditions where you live. Because of the dedication and determination of these individuals and organizations, today, all 100 county boards of elections in our state are open to the public. This morning, significant strides were made in our Helene response as it pertains to voting in the 2024 general election. The state board met earlier today and approved an extensive set of emergency measures designed to facilitate voting for Western North Carolinians most affected by Helene. The bipartisan board, comprised of Republicans and Democrats, voted unanimously on these measures. They were drafted in close coordination with county election officials, public safety and emergency management officials, and the U.S. Postal Service, among others. The emergency provisions are designated for the following counties: Ashe, Avery, Buncombe, Haywood, Henderson, Madison, McDowell, Mitchell, Polk, Rutherford, Transylvania, Watauga, and Yancey counties, as they remain severely disrupted as a result of the disaster and will continue to be disrupted through the election. Put simply, these measures will help eligible voters in the affected areas cast their ballot either in person or by mail, and they will help county boards of elections in Western North Carolina administer this election under extraordinarily difficult conditions. Earlier today, the state board sent out a press release detailing these measures. The release is available in the media section of the state board's website, which is ncsbe.gov, and it was sent to our distribution list of nearly 11,000 individuals. Today's resolution is linked in that press release and is also posted on ncsbe.gov/Helene, which is the special web page we created to disseminate information about Helene and voting. The complete video of this press conference will also be posted on the Helene web page as soon as possible after this press conference. Finally, we have every intention of starting early voting as scheduled on Thursday, October 17th in all 100 counties. Early voting may look different than expected in some of the 13 hardest hit counties, but it will go on. We also will continue to work with emergency management officials, the county boards of elections, and the U.S. Postal Service to ensure robust voting options for absentee and election day voting, as well as the early voting period. Our commitment and support for elections in North Carolina, particularly for those affected counties, does not end with a single board meeting and resolution. Today's actions allow us to move forward, adapt to the circumstances these counties and voters face, and ensure every eligible voter is able to cast their ballot in a safe and secure manner. And we'll go to Q&A now.
All right, thank you, Karen. As a reminder, if you have a question, please put your name and your media organization in the chat. We're gonna start with Michael McElroy from Cardinal and Pine. Michael, go ahead and unmute and ask your question. Michael, are you there?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Great, it's a very specific question, but can voters who in these areas who happen to be staying at shelters, can they use that shelter address to request their absentee ballot?
I think it's going to depend on whether they're going to be there long enough to receive the ballot there and whether the shelter is set up to receive materials for them, any kind of mail or so forth. We do have those circumstances where there are at times homeless individuals outside of a disaster who are able to receive mail at a shelter, but I don't want to assume that that would necessarily be possible in a disaster relief situation. So they may need to coordinate receiving mail at another site, a friend or relative or business that they're able to receive mail from. But we also know from the Postal Service that in these affected areas where there is no ability to receive mail at their residence address any longer, perhaps there's no mailbox, perhaps they can't get down that road to make deliveries, that mail is going to be held at the servicing post office for those individuals to be able to pick that mail up. So that would be another option. They could still have it sent to their home address and then go to the servicing post office that they would have used, or the post office is also setting up mobile units where they do not have a post office any longer. This process is somewhat similar. The post office is taking this action on their own, but it is very similar to when someone might be gone for an extended period of time and asks for their mail to be held at the post office. So they'll go in and retrieve their mail.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Now, just to add to that, Karen, that one simple way to think about this from a voter's perspective is, first, you got to figure out, yes, like Karen said, can your shelter actually receive mail? If so, then think about, all right, am I going to be here a week from today? Just a general rule of thumb, you know, it's going to take a little bit of time for the county board to process your absentee ballot and send it to you in the mail. It's probably not going to take as long as a week, but it's a pretty good rule of thumb to think about, like, how long you might need to be at a place to be able to receive the ballot once you make that request. So hopefully that's helpful.
Let's go to Kyle Ingram from News and Observer. Kyle, go ahead and unmute. Kyle, are you there? Kyle, can you unmute? Let's try again, Kyle.
Hi, Kyle.
Hey, sorry about that. I wanted to ask about the text of the resolution. It says that when you're changing early voting or election day polling sites, the counties will need to have a bipartisan majority vote. But would it still be allowed to do that if the majority vote was all Democrats, since those boards are 3-2?
What this provision is allowing for is that normally it would be a unanimous plan that would be sought in these situations. And we recognize that not all board members are going to be available. They may have been displaced or something of that nature. And so this board, the state board, in a bipartisan fashion, came to an agreement that a bipartisan majority would be acceptable. And so, no, in a circumstance of all three Democrats and no Republicans, provided that there are Republicans serving on the board and it's not just a Democrat board, we don't have that in any of these affected counties, but it would need to be a bipartisan agreement. So it could be the two Republican members and a Democrat in agreement, or it could be two Democrats and a Republican in agreement. And very likely, given the response that we have seen in these counties, it is not unexpected that we will still have a unanimous vote and bipartisan support as they rally around each other to see voting through.
All right, let's go to
Pat, real quickly, just so I can add to Kyle's. I'll also point out that under normal circumstances, early voting plan modifications would have to come back up to the state board. And this resolution, by having that bipartisan majority, is not requiring that. They will provide that information to the state board for us to disseminate that information. But if they have that bipartisan agreement, the state board members did not feel it necessary to call another state board meeting to review early voting plans that have to be modified because of this disaster.
Let's go to Mike Levine from ABC News. Mike, are you there? You can unmute.
Thanks for doing this. I just, in terms of quantifying what elections officials are facing, do you have any numbers you can provide? You know, things like how many polling locations may have been lost and how many of those are not expected to be replaced?
We're not quite there on those numbers, in part because one of the things that working with our state and federal emergency management officials allows for is that we actually can bring in temporary facilities. So it may be that a site is no longer usable because it was damaged in the storm, or perhaps it's being used for emergency purposes. We may be still able to use that lot, that parking lot, that land to erect a temporary facility and still be able to use the site. So that's part of what they are assessing. We're making those requests right now, today and tomorrow for the early voting sites if anything is needed. And we'll by the end of the week, we'll make those requests for other sites. We have in these affected counties, we have 62 early voting sites that were planned for. And that will possibly be reduced because early voting sites, some of those are being used as shelters. Some are also warehouses for the supplies that have been coming in. And early voting sites require larger facilities. So there may be some limitations there, just because of the use that's happening at those facilities. Similarly, we'll be making requests for Election Day sites. And if I remember correctly, we have over 270 Election Day sites among these counties. And so there will be the potential for some mergers in order to accommodate issues that have occurred in these polling places. But hopefully we're going to be able to accommodate the voters and somewhat take voting to the voters because they may be isolated. They may be having difficulties getting out of their homes or out of their communities in order to come to the county seats or main areas. So I can't exactly say that we are unable to use a certain number of sites at this point in time because our goal is to try to keep as many sites open as possible.
Got it. But the 62 and the 270 numbers, just the 13 counties, is that right?
Yes, I will double check that and we can get that information put into the chat.
Appreciate it.
Based upon our preliminary feedback from these counties, it was roughly 9 or 10 of these 62 sites for early voting that either had significant damage accessibility issues or it would their status was unknown as to whether it was going to be up and available by the time early voting started. That does not factor in the sites that are currently being used for disaster relief and are actively being used in recovery operations, for example, fire departments, that sort of thing. So that number in actuality may be slightly higher. But as Karen said, that doesn't mean that those sites will necessarily come offline. We're looking to see whether there are ways to maintain the use of a site despite its current state.
Got it. Thank you.
All right, let's go to Zara from Bloomberg News. Zara, you can unmute.
Beyond like the actual impact to the sites, I'm curious if you have any update on the impact to the volunteers who are slated to work at these early voting sites and precincts in terms of, do you know how many of them are still available or even in terms of those counties or what the response, what the plan will be to maybe replace and get new people on board?
This resolution certainly gave the counties some flexibility in with, designating workers for early voting and election day. We recognize that many of our workers are displaced. And some may still be needing to make that choice. A lot of these affected counties are still dealing with power issues and also water and sewer issues. And those are, the type of utilities and infrastructure that are difficult to repair and also make day-to-day living difficult. So they are, it's a very fluid situation on trying to determine how many people are available, but this resolution gave the counties the flexibility in order to bring in both other North Carolina registered voters from other counties to work, the ability to shift workers into other precincts for the counties, especially if they're needing to have experienced individuals working. things of that nature, so that they can better determine what needs they have and also to meet those needs. As they establish the exact number of polling places that they're going to be able to have open, that'll also help them determine how many workers that they need. And I think, one thing that we are hearing is that many of these people are staying in their community. It's home, and they want to give back to their community. And so being a part of the carrying out elections, they're always dedicated to that because they know that that is serving their fellow citizen. But in this time of such hardship, they're looking for ways to give back, and this is one of those ways that they can do so.
All right, let's move to Micaiah Seminara from the AP. Micaiah, you should be able to unmute. Micaiah, are you there?
On states that were impacted by Helene to extend their voter registration deadline. Has that been something that's been under consideration at all, in North Carolina, and what would be the state board's role in making that decision?
That was not a provision in this resolution, in part because our voter registration deadline is this coming Friday, October the 11th. And then when we start early voting on October the 17th through November the 2nd, same day registration is also an option for North Carolinians. And so we have a wide opportunity for folks to still get registered, even if they've been displaced. Now, we do have a residency requirement in North Carolina. They have to have been a resident of that county for 30 days. That would have been yesterday, Sunday, for that date. And so what we're guiding counties, or excuse me, guiding voters to consider is, have they temporarily relocated? If that's the case, then they will still remain, and participate through the county where they're registered in these affected areas. That may be best by mail through the absentee by mail program, or it may be through voting in person during the early voting or on election day, depending on how long they're temporarily away from their county. If they have relocated and intend that to be a permanent change, then they can register to vote and vote in their new county of residence.
Okay, let's move to Laura Leslie, WRAL. Laura, go ahead and unmute.
Thank you for taking my questions. My first question is, you mentioned temporary structures possibly being used in places where buildings are no longer available. What would those temporary structures look like, and would they be secure?
So we have the opportunity to use, for especially for Election Day, we can erect National Guard tents. This was done during Hurricane Dorian on the island of Ocracoke. And it's not as spacious as your normal polling location, but it does provide the space necessary at the existing voting site, if the parking lot and so forth are still accessible. We also are working with FEMA representatives. There are trailers or RVs that they can bring in, and we can set those up. We'll follow the same chain of custody procedures that we have in place in terms of the transport of equipment, the seals that are used on the equipment, on the ballot bins, on the voting equipment, and the poll books. We'll have the designated precinct officials who, by oath, will carry out a secure election and follow the chain of custody procedures, and we'll also follow secure methods to return those materials to the boards of elections. It really, even in a temporary structure, we can still maintain security of the voting equipment and safety for our workers in those circumstances.
Okay, thanks. And just one quick follow-up. For voters who are displaced, who have their absentee ballots, should they trust the mail to take them back to their county board of elections back in those counties? Or well, you mentioned something this morning about them being able to return them to the county where they're staying.
Yes, so we have a provision within this resolution that an individual who is from one of the displaced counties, that voter or near relative or legal guardian can return their absentee ballot to any county board of elections in North Carolina and as long as they do so by 7:30 p.m. on election day. They may feel more comfortable. They may be going to a neighboring county for supplies or something of that nature. So this seemed to offer up an opportunity for them to do that when getting to a post office or a mail receptacle might be more difficult right now. They might not have adequate postage, things of that nature. They can still take their absentee ballot to their county board of elections if that's accessible to them. That's always permitted. That's in any of our counties, in any of our elections, if they so choose. We also opened up the opportunity. It's already within state law that a voter can return their absentee ballot to an early voting site if they so choose. But in these affected counties, they'll be able to take it to an election day voting site in their county, and as long as they do so by the close of polls. In terms of the mail, what we know from the Postal Service is that because the county offices are back open, and most of the county seats as a whole are very much back open and functioning with power and internet and good road system to get in and out. The Postal Service is delivering and receiving mail from our county boards of elections. So at this point in time, there's no indication that there's disruption in delivering mail to the county boards of elections in any of these counties, or for them to be able to send out absentee ballots or voter cards or any of those materials to the voters.
So to put a finer point on it, I'd say the voters can feel comfortable to mail their ballot back to a county board of elections at this point. Those county boards of elections, even in the disaster area, are receiving mail.
Hey, we're going to go to Destiny from Q City Metro. Destiny, you can unmute. Try again, Destiny. One more try, Destiny. If we can't get you now, we'll try to come back. Destiny, are you there? Okay, let's move to Jane Tim, NBC News. Jane, go ahead and try to unmute.
This is Jane Tim, NBC. Thank you for making the time for us. Curious if you had any reports of mail ballots being, you know, in any sort of quantity being destroyed by the floods or lost by the floods, or a lot of people requesting replacement mail ballots. Curious if you've had any indication of when that storm hit based on when your ballots were sent out, the first batches, if that was creating a problem.
There certainly were some that were, you know, not delivered or to the homes or back to the County Board of Elections. And we are still working through identifying those. But any voter who's concerned about the status of their ballot can certainly, if they had made the request, they can sign up for ballot tracks, which is a service that we provide to all voters who vote absentee by mail, where they can follow their ballot in the mail stream. So that's helping to identify for many voters. We did receive some ballots back already that had gone out on the date that civilian ballots were sent out, which was September 24th, which was the Tuesday before the storm hit. So we know that many did receive their ballots, but we are also making sure that voters know that if they need to request an additional ballot, that is not a problem. They can contact their county board of elections, ask to have the original request discarded and have a new ballot reissued. It can go to their same address, or they can update their request to a new address where they're able to receive mail.
All right, let's move to Liz Landers from Scripps. Liz, go ahead and unmute.
For doing this, Karen. I just wanted to ask you, local, state, and federal officials have spoken pretty forcefully about misinformation surrounding the overall response to the hurricane. Can you describe the kind of election misinformation that you are hearing and potentially quantify it? How much of it are you hearing? And what do you think the impact of the misinformation could be on the elections in North Carolina?
Misinformation around elections has been an ongoing issue for many years now. And we just really ask people to go to trusted sources of information. That is part of why we set up the special page on Helene, ncsbe.gov/Helene, so people can get the right and accurate information. Similarly, we're working with our county boards as they have the access again to their web pages to get information so that the voters have that as a trusted source. The reality is, I'm trying not to keep up with all the disinformation or misinformation that's out there, because we have more work to do to make sure that the right information is getting out there to the voters. But it is not helpful. And matter of fact, it is a disservice to these people who have already faced disaster and have been put in harm's way and are hurting. What a disgrace for anyone to try to provide misinformation or disinformation affecting their ability to vote. And one of the things that has been said is that we are doing our actions in some sort of partisan manner. And I hope that it is very clear to everyone today that that state board acted in a nonpartisan manner. I, as executive director, acted in a nonpartisan manner. And our commitment at this state board and in those county boards of elections is to ensure that every eligible voter is able to cast their ballot in this election, no matter what county they're in. It's also been suggested that I'm partisan in my actions, and I would remind everyone that this is my adopted home. I served the 12 counties of Western North Carolina in my first job in elections. I know these people, I know these roads, and it fazes me not what their political stripe is. I want to make sure that these people are safe from this storm and able to carry out their right to vote through this. And I worked as a county election official in a county that was, actually has more unaffiliated voters than any political party. And, these people are dear to me, and I don't care what their political affiliation is. We're going to get this job done, because that's our work, no matter what the election, no matter the circumstances, is to ensure that every eligible voter is able to cast their ballot.
Thanks, Karen. Hope you all heard that response. Renee Umstead from the News and Observer. Go ahead and unmute, Renee. Renee, are you there?
Is ballots being received after the deadline to be counted, or election mail being returned as undeliverable, may affect voting in North Carolina?
So the provisions today still adhere to our deadline for absentee ballots, which is the close of polls on election day, 7:30 p.m. November the 5th. We need all absentee ballots in the affected counties and the unaffected counties to be returned by 7:30 p.m. election day. I think some of the consideration is to create consistency. The messaging is already out there that these are the deadlines. And because of some of the communication channel issues, difficulty in self-service and internet connectivity, it is very hard to communicate a different deadline to voters. We also recognize that in these affected counties, their media markets stretch into other states, stretch into other metropolitan areas of North Carolina, such as Winston-Salem and Charlotte. And we don't want to create confusion for the voters in the affected counties or the voters outside of the affected counties. So at this time, the board is choosing to maintain the deadline that we have in place, which is 7:30 p.m. election day, that all absentee ballots must be received back to the county board elections. And in this case, in these affected counties, they will have the option to deliver that ballot to an election day voting site, or they can deliver it to another county board of elections, just as long as it's received by 7:30 p.m. election day.
All right.
Just flagging, sorry, Pat, just flagging that. Pat, you added into the chat the number of early voting sites in the 13 counties. Just, we were speaking earlier about around 60 early voting sites. That was a tally when we were looking at a larger number of counties in the region and assessing their damages. The 13 counties that were the subject of this resolution include 40 early voting sites. So that's just a clarification on those numbers.
Thanks, Paul. Sarah Gleason from Asheville Citizen Times. Thanks for being here, Sarah. Go ahead and unmute. Sarah, are you there?
More counties affected than the 13 ones mentioned in the resolution. If a voter from one of those counties that isn't listed is still affected by the storm, is there any way that they can request to be included in any of these resolutions, or is there any way for them to get any other exceptions?
The provisions adopted today by the state board were for the 13 counties because they show signs of continued disruption today, and it appears that that will be the case through early voting, election day, and likely into our canvas certification period. The other counties that received designation through the Federal Natural Disaster Declaration, which were 25 counties, and then three others that have tribal land, those were not considered because what we have been able to establish is that they are very much back online, have very limited circumstances. And so voters outside of these 13 counties do not fall into the provisions that we have in place for these 13 counties.
Let's move to Greg from Mountain Express. Greg from Mountain Express, go ahead and unmute. Greg, are you there?
Aaron?
Yes, there you are.
Thank you. Just a quick clarification on what you said earlier about near relatives who can vote for someone who's in one of the affected counties in a different county. I just wanted to get clarification on what a near relative would be if someone from Buncombe County needed to deliver their absentee ballot to, Iredell County or something.
Right. Just to clarify, they cannot vote for a near relative, but they can make a request for a voter, or they can deliver the ballot for a voter. The same applies for legal guardian. There's a list that we can provide you of what constitutes a near relative, but it's generally mother, father, spouse, brother, sister, daughter, son. Those are the primary near relatives. I think there might be a provision allowing for in-laws as well, but we can put that in the chat just so you have the entirety of who a near relative is considered in North Carolina.
Yeah, we have. There's a provision of the statutes that defines near relatives for absentee voting. That's General Statute 163-226F, as in Frank. And it's spouse, brother, sister, parent, grandparent, child, grandchild, mother-in-law, father-in-law, daughter-in-law, son-in-law, step-parent, or stepchild.
I remembered those pretty well.
Thank you. And I just had another follow-up. Is there anything in state law or state board policy that would prevent any counties from running early voting locations, for example, using generator power or without running water? And is there anything like the establishment of porta potties necessary or recommended from the state board? And if so, where might boards get funding for that?
So our federal partners through state emergency management have indicated a commitment to support this election and to provide the needed items, many of which you listed. So we will be coordinating with our emergency management officials to not only provide temporary facilities, but we can have temporary restrooms, porta potties, things of that nature set up. Generators are being supplied if needed. And we are working with the voting system vendors to make sure that we are providing adequate generator service for the voting equipment. But they do have lengthy battery life, so that's another option that can help us with the voting equipment at these sites. So things of that nature are definitely being worked through to, even if an early voting site does not have running water or power, but is accessible, then we can still work with the counties to make use of those early voting sites.
Okay, thank you. And you said earlier that all of the 13 counties have their boards are up and running and in power and can be contacted at this time. All
That's
13, right?
all 13. That's correct. All 100 county boards of elections are open today.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Zoe from Duke Chronicle. Go ahead and unmute. Zoe, are you there?
Yes. Wonderful. Thank you. You just answered my first question. But do you have a projected timeline for when all of the designated polling locations in those 13 counties will be fully functional, like in time for early voting next week and by Election Day?
We don't know that they will be in time for early voting or Election Day. And so that's why we're making the request that we are. The instruction we were given by our emergency officials, emergency management officials, was to consider if voting were needing to be taking place today, what would those facilities need in order to be functioning? So those are the asks that we are making. Obviously, those are individual circumstances for those facilities. Similarly, the board, county boards, needed the authorization from the state board today so that they can meet and adopt some of these changes to polling places, changes to election workers, and changes to early voting sites to accommodate and identify what we'll need at these facilities in order to keep them operational.
But in terms of time frame, early voting will start next Thursday, October 17th, and Election Day will occur November 5th on Tuesday. So these voters in the sites that in the counties that are we've identified will have the opportunity to early vote and will have the opportunity to vote on Election Day. The issues that the county boards are now working through due to the additional authorities the state board gave it today are, you know, are there going to be some modifications to the sites that are available for early voting starting next Thursday, or the sites that are available for Election Day on November 5th? And so that's what they're working through right now. And as soon as those changes, if any, are made, the county boards and we will attempt to get the word out as soon as possible.
Obviously, this disaster is not just affecting how we conduct elections. It's affecting day-to-day life. And many of these communities will be without power, without water, without internet, without cell service, potentially for weeks. Some may even be facing months. And so our job is to figure out, as long as there are citizens in those communities, how do we provide them with voting opportunities so that they can exercise their right to vote? And we will make workarounds with the facilities, with the power supply, and so forth to do that job.
All right, we have about 15 minutes left, so we'll try to get through everybody if we can, but if not, you all know my email address and feel free to follow up. Let's go to Annie Dance, Cops in Congress. Annie, go ahead and unmute.
Hi, thank you for taking my question. If another hurricane hits closer to Election Day, say the day before, are there any certain plans that the board has to ensure voters can still cast their ballots? For example, landslides affecting roads and so on?
The board can call an emergency meeting at any time necessary, and we can put forth proposals to them to address any further circumstances that may happen in these 13 affected counties, or heaven forbid, in other counties that might be faced with a hurricane or other natural disaster between now and Election Day. But we will prepare to take action immediately with the state board and working with our emergency management officials. You know, one of the things that has been very obvious for us through this disaster is that we have had a standing working relationship with state emergency management officials and our federal partners, our North Carolina National Guard, and it's allowed us to be responsive and to coordinate quickly on what our needs are as the counties came back on board, back online, and able to assess their situations. So if we face another natural disaster between now and November 5th, that established relationship and the commitment of our state board members to act swiftly is going to be what sees us through.
Thank you.
I'll also offer up to everyone, if you can't tell, we're going to keep making ourselves available to you all. You are helping us to get the word out to the people in these affected communities, and we thank you for that. And we're sorry we can't give you more than an hour today, but there will be other media availability, and we'll continue, as Pat says, to answer your questions and be responsive to your emails and phone calls.
Brian Anderson. Brian, go ahead and unmute. Brian, you there?
Brian Anderson here. Can everyone hear me okay?
We can.
Thank you. I'll try to be quick. I had two questions really. For the first one, lawmakers are returning on Wednesday. What, if any, asks does the State Board of Elections have for state lawmakers when they return? And if they can't get it done this week, do you want Cooper to call an emergency session or lawmakers to draft and modify their adjournment resolution?
So we have been in communication with our legislative leaders and their staff. We have made a funding request that helps us to support the counties and helps them in some of their needs. But obviously, to be able to carry out voting starting next Thursday, we have worked with our federal officials and the funds that they have. We've worked with our state budget office for emergency funds that are already designated that we can tap into. We've had discussions with the legislative leadership staff about the provisions we were going forward with today. And fortunately, our laws are nimble enough that the state board has the emergency authority needed to take those actions today and does not require in those cases for the legislature to act. So really, we're looking to the legislature, as many agencies are that are supporting the county efforts and response, to look at funding that can be made available to us as a state agency in support or potentially directly to the counties.
All right, I'm going to Lily from Blue Ridge Public Radio. I want to make sure our friends out in the western part of the state get their questions answered today. Go ahead, Lily.
We've heard of you. I think you mentioned in the Board of Elections meeting earlier today that some counties might have to move their early voting sites to another county nearby that hasn't been as impacted. Can you share which counties those are and also what counties have already received the attack response kits that you mentioned at last week's meeting?
So great questions. In terms of the provision that a voting site can be set up in an adjacent county, that was a provision that's in the resolution for election day purposes. So if because of the, we're dealing with the mountains, as you well know, and ridge lines often cut off access points. So if it's easier to come down the west side of that ridge line and into a neighboring county, and there's a polling place or a facility that can be used as a polling place and still be accessible to members of that community, then we have authorized for them to set up a polling place across the county line, but just for that election day precinct. So there's not intended to be a setup of early voting sites outside of the county itself. So we'll remain having those in the affected counties. And then your second question about the ARC. So the attack response kits. The good news is that our service providers were working swiftly to get cellular service on wheels. Or to get in Starlinks or to set up internet service again. So ultimately, very few of our ARCs were deployed. I know that we've taken them into, I believe, we never had to take one into Haywood or Henderson. They were able to get service back before we needed to take those in. We have set them up in Mitchell, I believe Avery and Yancey. I think ultimately those were the only, I take that back. Watauga County also made use of an ARC. They no longer need it, but early on they did make use of one of the attack response kits that originally intended for cybersecurity use, but have been effective in an emergency situation.
And
Hey,
did
Lily,
Haywood
don't.
County have one as well? Sorry. Oh, go ahead.
Initially, we were setting one up for Haywood, but ultimately they were able to get services back to their county office. Without needing one to do their day-to-day operations.
And Lily, the follow-up I was going to have on the first question is that, we don't know if any of the county boards in these 13 counties are going to find it necessary to set up a voting location for a precinct in a neighboring adjacent county. It's just a provision that's allowing them to do so if it just so happens that that precinct, the location that they have available is unusable or inaccessible to their voters, And they have another option that is just across the county line and it's close by, and they can make that available to those particular voters. So we don't know that this is going to be a provision that's going to be used, just like a lot of these provisions. It's just there to provide the flexibility to the county board for any eventuality. So if you have that particular set of circumstances, then the county board can consider doing something like that. But we don't anticipate this being a broadly used type of mechanism.
Right. And I did just have a quick clarifying question about the Postal Service. We've pretty much been understanding that it's still pretty patchy as far as whether or not mail is being delivered. Are y'all saying that the Postal Service is able to work with the county boards of elections right now in all of the counties in the region?
Yes, that's what's been communicated to us and what we're finding out from the counties as well. So delivery and receipt of mail seems to be happening with all county boards of elections at this point.
There's a distinction between, you know, the county board of elections and their accessibility to mail, and obviously the community that is in the same county, all the communities in the same county. There are a lot of communities that still have accessibility issues, of course, within a county, but the county office, as far as we know, as far as we've been told by the Postal Service and the counties, is able to send and receive mail. So the issue is going to be and delivery in those sites that the Postal Service has identified as being difficult to reach right now or unreachable.
Thanks, so.
Let's go to another media outlet from out west, Madison Smith, WLOS. Madison, go ahead and unmute. Madison, you should be able to unmute.
Can you hear me?
Yes, there you are, Madison.
Great. I wanted to ask about, with the misinformation going around and their possible threats with it, and the idea of this election already being contentious and this happening during an election month, is there going to be extra security at some of these temporary and original election sites or voting sites?
So in case others couldn't hear your question well, you were asking about security at any of these temporary sites or any of the election day sites in the affected areas. We actually see, you know, a real spirit of community happening. And I don't think that that we're going to need to be worried about that. I think more where our law enforcement officials may be of help is really escorting potentially some of our workers, just because of the hours of election day being 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. And by November 5th, it's going to be dark during the hours they arrive and the hours that they leave. And given the conditions of some of these roads and so forth, we may need law enforcement assistance to safely transport our workers to and from their facilities and the County Board of Elections and so forth. But as a general law in North Carolina, we are not permitted to have law enforcement stationed at our voting sites. And, you know, if need be, if there's a disruption, if we need them to help in peacekeeping, they can be called in for those purposes to a voting site, but they cannot be present. We recognize in our laws that while they have service in our processes, for some people that could be intimidating. And so, you know, our efforts at our voting sites is to ensure that everyone is able to cast their ballot without fear of intimidation. So we will continue that process in all 100 counties of North Carolina.
Let's go to Sarah Michaels from Carolina Public Press. Sarah, go ahead and unmute.
These emergency measures, there's a few things boards can do, like changing dates and times. Is there a deadline for when they have to make those decisions by? And a follow-up on Brian's question, how much are you all asking in funding from the legislature, and what is the cost looking like right now?
In terms of the county boards have the time that they need to assess what they in the changes they may need to make in order to deliver early voting, that even included that they could change the hours or reduce the days if necessary. But we anticipate that there will be at least an early voting site open in every county from the 17th through November the 2nd, with potentially additional days or a change of hours. If they find, as they set up and begin to deliver voting, that there's any issues discovered at these facilities, then obviously they have the means within this resolution to make adjustments as they need to, as long as it's with bipartisan majority support. And then the second question, we can get you a more exact number, but I believe the ask that we made to the legislature was right around $2 million.
Thank you.
Our ask to the federal authorities, we don't have a calculation on that yet.
All right. I think we have time for one more, maybe two, if we make it quick. Brianna Lyman from the Federalist. Do you have a question, Brianna?
Just checking to see if you guys could hear me.
We can.
Yes, ma'am.
Go ahead, Brianna.
Yeah, during the last meeting, I think there might have been just something briefly mentioned about the possibility of online voting. I just wanted to see if the NCSB was looking into any possible future resolutions that would include that, and if so, what that might look like, or if that's been completely ruled out.
Yeah, I think that was offered up as a suggestion from a member of the media. And we have certainly weighed all ideas and have brainstormed a number of options. At this point in time, we have not actioned that. You may or may not realize that North Carolina does have a provision within our law that allows for electronic transmission and ballot return by our military and overseas citizens. And through that, we are able to offer a service called OmniBallot, where they can receive their ballot and return their ballot through an electronic portal. This portal also allows for civilians, non-military and overseas citizens, to make their requests, but our law does not allow for electronic voting for non-military and overseas citizen, with one exception that there is a provision for based upon a court decision that the visually impaired may receive and cast their ballot through that system. So that has not been extended beyond the military, overseas, or visually impaired voters in our state. We will look at whether that is necessary in order to carry out voting. If we can always have another emergency meeting of the board to consider further actions, be it this or other provisions. But at this time, one of the considerations that we had to make was, where are we with Postal Service delivery? And since the Postal Service seems to have identified ways to accommodate the voters and have them receive their ballots, we're also able to reissue ballots and those kind of things. It doesn't, at this point in time, I don't believe the General Counsel or I, either one, would be making that recommendation to the State Board to extend the electronic voting to all the voters in the affected counties.
Let's do one more. That's all we're going to have time for, and I can respond to the questions in the chat, or if you want to email me directly, I can respond directly to you. Let's go to Lynn Bonner, NC Newsline. Lynn, go ahead and unmute. This will be the last question. Lynn, are you there? Lynn Bonner, are you still there? All right, I guess we won't have any more questions, but there was, I did get a question by text from another reporter who's asking to confirm what the 62 number was. I believe that was the total number of early voting sites in a larger number of counties where the emergency declaration was, or disaster was declared. The number we put in the chat by county for a total of 40 are the number of early voting sites in the 13 counties that the resolution today covers. And Paul,
thanks, here. Feel free to jump.
Oh,
can
yeah.
I have my question in quickly? Thanks.
Yeah, Lynn's there. Go ahead, Lynn.
How will you get the word out to people who have left their county that they can deliver their ballot to any county or to any county office? How do you tell the people that?
Well, certainly you're a part of getting that message out, and it's why we find these media availabilities so important. We will certainly be posting to our dedicated webpage, ncsbe.gov/Helene. We have other communication planned at the disaster relief sites and places of that nature. We will be posting it in areas where people are generally gathering at this point. And then it can be flagged for the voter if they're calling back in to make a second request for a new delivery of their absentee ballot.
Thank you.
Paul, do you want to add the details that are in the resolution about, I don't have them off the top of my head, but there are provisions in the resolution about notification to voters and posting publicly of types of information?
Yeah, anytime there's a change being made to voting sites in particular, there are provisions in the resolution requiring a notification to go out to the public. As Karen mentioned, it through sunshine lists in the media, and also the disaster relief stations, as Karen mentioned. Additionally, if there's a change in an election day site for a particular group of voters, those group of voters are going to be sent a mailing about that. And if they can't receive mail, there's additional measures for email and for other means of communication, such as the media, at the local media, and the posting that Karen mentioned in the places where folks are gathering for disaster recovery in the counties.
Okay, we're going to end this there. Thank you all for participating. We will have, like as Karen said, we'll have more media availabilities. We will post this video to the Helene website as soon as we can this afternoon. The press release is out. It's on our website, ncsbe.gov, in the media section. That's the press release about the resolution that the state board passed unanimously today. And there's a link to that in that press release to the resolution, which is also linked to on the Helene webpage. So you should be able to find all the information you need in multiple places. I've also tweeted and put on Facebook information, but please feel free as always to reach out if you still need anything. So thanks, Paul. Thanks, Karen. And thank you all.
Thanks, everybody. We appreciate you.
Thank you all.
There you have it. That's what officials said today, Monday, October 7th, from the North Carolina State Board of Elections. A few numbers for you. According to them, there are over 7.7 million registered voters as of Saturday, October 5th, and over 284,000 absentee ballots were requested through October 6th. So there's, as you heard, there's systems in place for those affected absentee ballot requesters. And if you have not registered to vote yet, the deadline is fast approaching of October 11th at 5 p.m. So there's more information on their website, and you can follow those links to register to vote to read more and learn more about that. Thank you very much for watching. Please again subscribe to AnnieDance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter, where I work to shine a light on these very important issues. See you next time.